or heard from. I am going to officially call the, okay, we are recorded. I just thought about that. I'm going to officially call the meeting to order. So if we can have roll call by one of SEMA staff members, that'd be awesome.
Ash, will you handle that or do you want me to?
I would like you to. Thank you, Linda.
Sure. No problem. Chair Hughes.
Present.
Vice Chair Doe.
Present.
Treasurer Mullins.
Present.
Secretary Yolanda Adams-Lee.
Here.
Abdirahman Dahir. Alfreda Daniels Juasime.
Here.
Andre Dukes.
Present.
Carl Crawford. Jude Nadi.
Present.
Mayor, the illustrious Mayor Hollis Winston.
Thank you, Hollis. Hollis works.
Hollis. Hollis Winston. Great. And then Senator Fate, did I miss anyone?
Nope, I think you're good.
Okay. Perfect.
All right, awesome. If I can have a motion to adopt the meeting agenda, unless there's any additions or edits.
I move, Nadi.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second, Dukes.
Awesome. All in favor? Aye.
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 Any opposed? Any abstentions? Motion carries. Thank you for that. The consent agenda item, hopefully everybody had a chance to read the November 22nd meeting minutes, because that would have been our last time that we would have met, because we did not meet in December. So if there are any, if there aren't any corrections or additions, if I can have a motion to adopt the consent agenda item, which is basically the approval of the meeting minutes from November. Were there any additions? Let me ask that question first again. Or corrections? All right, if I can have a motion to accept it. To approve it, rather.
So move.
Thank you, Wayne. Is there a second?
Second, Lee.
Thank you, Yolanda. And if all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any oppose? Any abstention? Motion carries. All right. Look at that. Just like that, we're on time. Tawana, I'm going to turn it over to you, Treasurer Mullins, for our financial report.
Okay. Let me know when you all can see it.
We can.
Okay, so we're currently at about $138,000 in unobligated monies for the remainder of the fiscal year, which is coming up real fast. We didn't get to have our executive meeting this month. So I don't know, Linda, does the council have any ideas on how we plan to expend that money yet?
We do, and I believe it might be an agenda item. I'm not sure if it is, but
it is. It is in the agenda item.
Okay. So we do have some thoughts, and I would love to get some input from the council as well.
Okay, perfect. Well, that is all I had. I went through the expenditure reports and all the other, and everything looks fine. We're in the positive everywhere. So I guess just spending down that money before we lose it July 1, is the main priority.
Perfect. Any questions from the other council members in reference to this? And just as a reminder, because I know it's been a minute, but just keeping in mind that because of the way that our that the council is set up, predominantly you're going to see more salaries. I mean, so it's going to be heavily staff driven or salaries that you're going to see as far as, you know, the organization, because we're not necessarily a heavy program, you know, driven organization. So that's why you see majority of our dollars do come from salaries. But then there's also some other expenditures that we do, you know, utilize to run the organization. So just keep that in mind. And because it is a financial report, there's nothing for us to vote on. It's just more of making sure that you all are in the loop of what we have.
Yes. Perfect. Thank you all.
No, thank you. And because we will have a further discussion, you know, if there are questions, which one of the questions that Tawana did raise was, you know, what's the plan? But that is one of the agenda items, because I had told Linda, let's just have a separate discussion around that. I'm going to move on. I don't believe we have any public on the call. I think it's all council members, if I'm not mistaken. Just kind of quickly perusing. Yes. So with that, we're going to move ahead into the 2022 year in review is the next agenda item.
Okay, perfect. So 2022 was a good year. Again, we started off with actually three people, full-time people, and then we lost Shakira in March to another department. And then we brought on Flockamy, though, in January. So that kind of brought us back up. But then we were down, like I said, again, to three people until we were blessed to have Ash join us in November. So we are excited to say that we are at four people right now, although Theo has been out of the country for a few weeks. So it's kind of felt like three people again. But I'm excited to have a full staff, and we have some great things going. So year 2022 was a fantastic year for us, just in terms of getting some things going, but not necessarily so for the legislature. We know that everything was pretty much at a standstill. It was bogged down just because it was a bonding year. So I'm going to cover, I don't know how many people looked at the annual report yet, but I thought maybe I would just kind of walk us through the annual report, because it does tell us where we've been and what we've been doing. So I'm going to share my screen right now. Okay, so this year, we're standing strong. So we went from being empowered, you know, we had the George Floyd tragedy, and we came out and we said, hey, we need to be empowered. We got to stand up. Enough is enough, right? So we came out, stood with the community, and then we moved from empowerment to advocacy. And I apologize for having to look at my other computer, but I'm trying to, you know, annual report and my notes. But we came out and we said, hey, we need to try to move some legislation. We need to work with the community to get some bills out there to address some of the ills that are happening in our community. So our last year's theme was advocacy. This year, our theme is resilience. You know, even though, you know, we're empowered, we're fired up, we're ready to go. We were advocating last year, but again, the legislature really didn't move on anything. But we are here. We are standing strong with our community. And so that is the message that we are trying to communicate to the community, our constituents, to the legislature, that we are here. We have some wants, some needs, and desires, and we're standing strong, and we're not going anywhere until we get what we came for.
All right. Linda, can you click on the arrow so that we remove and it makes it a little bit bigger? It's the arrow next to the tools. One? Nope. It's the, so if you're looking at the document, come up, you see where the tools are showing, and there should look be her, an arrow to expand.
Her earrings, her left earrings.
Yeah, where her earrings are. If you click on that.
On her left earring?
Left, you see, the other side. The other earring, the other one, keep going.
No, okay, I guess I'm not seeing exactly.
So you're going to remove what I'm trying to remove is the tools. Yes. Yeah, so yeah. You see the arrow, you can, you were right there. I don't see how you missed it.
Okay. Tell me if I'm going in the right direction.
Go back to the right. You see, okay. You see where export PD and organize, and there's a click on that arrow to the left. You'll click and it'll expand.
Oh, that
it.
Arrow. Okay.
Yes.
Great.
Thank you.
Perfect. See, you are never too old where you can't learn something. So that's a lesson. You know, every day we should be learning something new. So I didn't realize that. So thank you.
Yes, you're welcome.
All right. So perfect. So I'm just going to kind of go through the annual report. Okay. No, we don't want that to happen. So what I'll do is just go down. And this, unfortunately, is still in... Okay. Hold on just a second. Okay, now it's frozen. Well, I'm just going to do that. There's our lovely, amazing chair. Right there. And if I move to the right, you will see me, but we're not, there's no need for that. Okay, so we stand strong with righteous resiliency. Again, the whole theme of resilience, standing resolute. We're there. And so this page here just kind of covers our mission because, you know, there are some people who just don't know who we are and what we do, right? So we want to make sure that they know that. Okay, now if you pan over to the right, it's the landscape of who we are. How many people belong to the African Heritage Community? So we have about 505,000 people, which still makes us the second largest group in the state at 7.4% of the state. Our economy is still over $14 billion. We have about 20,000 in Black-owned businesses. The African immigrant community is very strong, and there's about 3,200 businesses, entrepreneurial businesses. So we are growing and we are an economic engine, right? Okay, so. Let's see here. So I'm going to go down and then I'm going to go back over because this is double. So again, the whole thing, we're reiterating, we stand strong with policies that elevate. We are a policy-making organization. We look at community, we chat with them, provide a voice, and then we take what we know to be true from what they've told us, and we bring that back, and then we partner with agencies and the legislature to change those policies that are negatively impacting our people, and then also looking at how can we elevate the African Heritage Community.
So, Linda, can we just quick go back to page 3? The numbers. So I'm looking at, we got to I see it says Black or African-American Minnesotans. We've always changed it to African Heritage. And then we've also put a caveat because, as we know, African Heritage has never been holistically calculated correctly.
Exactly. And so if you look, there is a note.
Okay, that's what I was looking for.
Yeah, and can you put that in the chat? So for those of you maybe who did not get to make comments or what have you, if you have some thoughts, clearly we can't, you know, rewrite the annual report. But if you see something that, hey, you know, that seems to be... something that needs to be looked at, We can do that, but I only have until tomorrow morning to do that. So if you didn't get to it and you feel like, you know, making some changes or whatever, let me know. And just so you all do know, these numbers actually did come, and we'll need to have that sentence there. So this is a draft. This is a draft. This is data that came directly from the census, the state demographer. So we didn't make up these numbers. This is how, this is what they came up with. But Chair Hughes, if you can put that information in the chat or send me a little email, I'll take a look at it just to make sure that it does not change the dynamics of what is written. So you're kind of saying, hey, 2021 population of African heritage or African American Minnesotans.
So we could say right now it says 2021 population of Black or African American Minnesotans. You can rechange it to say 2021 population for Minnesotans of African heritage or something like that.
Can one of the somebody on the team make a note of that? I'll just check with the demographer to make sure that that doesn't change in terms of the date.
Trying to see what we had because, of course, I have 2021 right here.
Council Chair Hughes, can you repeat the last point that Linda wanted us to note just so I can type it for notes?
You know what? Never mind. Because I looked at what we did last year and we had the same thing last year.
Okay.
So we missed it last year. So we still had the note about the populations, but I guess I totally missed that it did say 2020 population of Black or African American Minnesotans. So I guess we're okay.
Okay.
Because I was going to change the title, Ash, but we're good. Because I wanted to be consistent with what we did last year. So fine. Go ahead. Keep going. Sorry.
Oh, no, not a problem. That's why we're here. And again, we're standing strong. Okay, okay, I feel like I'm getting an echo. Does somebody have two things open, maybe?
No, Wayne is unmuted, and I don't know if that's, I'm going to mute myself, though.
Okay, all right. Okay, great. So we know that that's a space where we need some help in that space in terms of the numbers, because we are way undercounted. Okay, so let's see. So we've all already talked about how we're elevating things. And then the council advocated in five areas, and they're similar to the same areas that we're doing again this year. So that would be economic security, which is, you know, public, private investments and business, employment and workforce development. So there's a bunch of things that fall up under that, but that's kind of a main thread. Under education equity, let's close the opportunity gap. You know, every student deserves a high quality education. So we're looking at that, looking at also making sure that we have, you know, the mental health and the technology resources for our students. That's a must. Under health justice, we spent a lot of time addressing health challenges, which we know were exacerbated by COVID. So we're always at the bottom of the totem pole, but this time we're at the top, meaning we were most affected, right? Public safety, we're advancing human rights. Police accountability was another key one for us this year. And then violence prevention. And all of that is combined really so that we can have strong families and communities. And so that means investing, you know, fiscally and in technical ways in child welfare, housing system redesign. So that is where we are. So we know that we're in this for long-term gains, right? I just want to make sure. And bear with me. I'm sorry that this is has to be set up this way, but I was unable to get a. I'm going backwards. I was unable to get a separate one. Okay, so some of the other things that we've been doing, we know is for the long term. And I don't know if Flacamia end up talking about some of this, but We've been doing some partnering, and I know she's going to discuss partnering a little later, but for long-term gains, you know, we talked about 21 Days of Peace, and that was a church-led initiative, and we put that in there, again, because even though a lot of us weren't out there, I was an area director for that, and I always made sure that people knew that the council was out there, and I was firm and religiously supported that, not because just because of the work, but because I wanted people to know that, hey, the council cares about what's going on in our community. We care about public safety. We care about stopping the violence. So that's one place that we were in, and then working with, and I'm going to take that Linda Sloan out there because, you know, that they put that in there. But we did some work with the Missing and Murdered Women's and Girls Task Force, and that information will be presented to the legislature in this upcoming session. And we spent a lot of work on the post board reform. Let's see, and Peace Officer Standards Training Board. Did Carl join us? Okay, so he's not there, but just so you guys know.
Yeah, there's a couple of questions in the chat. He's there.
Yes, Executive Sloan, I'm here.
Okay, so Council Member Crawford, I just wanted to say, is our new representative on the Ensuring Police Excellence and Improving Community Relations Advisory Council. And maybe he can talk a little bit about the work that they're doing. So we submitted letters to drive some change, but Carl is on the board now. So maybe talk a little bit about the work that you're doing and how you're showing up as a council member.
Absolutely. Thank you. Happy New Year, everyone. The work that we're doing right now, we had community members show up with a very critical thing that's happening in our communities, and that is capturing the DNA of adolescent Black youth. That was brought to our attention. I'm currently working with the commission to draft a letter that will be presented to the post board and creating a task force to look deeper into why is this DNA being captured without parents knowing about this that's happening in our community, who owns that DNA, and for what purpose and how long will they have it? And this is really critical as we start to see how, in some cases, the judicial system is tracking our youth and creating yet a larger pipeline to prison. Thank you.
Wow. Thank you for sharing that. I wasn't aware of that. So the letter that you're drafting, is that going to be from Duluth Human Rights? And if so, then SEMA will need to do a letter as well.
I would love for SEMA to join in doing a letter. No, this will be as part of my hat for the Pulse Advisory Board.
Okay. All right. So thank you. You know, I so appreciate Councilmember Crawford jumping on. We had someone, Nick Muhammad, who was great, but he was spread kind of thin. And so Councilmember Crawford just said, hey, I'll do it. And I'm excited about, you know, how you're showing up, going to the meetings, making our voice heard, because he represents us as we represent the community. So thank you for that.
Thank you.
Okay. I can't see what's in the chat. Are there questions for me?
There are. So I can, and it kind of goes back. So Alfreda had asked how recent are the numbers, but I think I responded. I think you responded to that. And then she said, okay. She said, okay, got it. And then Councilmember Lee said she'd like to know the African-American numbers regarding business, et cetera. Mm-hmm. And then she also stated we need to not only indicate immigrants. And then Councilmember Crawford asked, is there a special section about the impact of COVID in our communities? And then he just said he apologized if he jumped the gun, which you were fine, you didn't.
No. And just to Councilmember Lee, that number wasn't readily available. I will go back and again chat with Dr. Corey about that. But for some reason that number was not, but I will check on that. So the team can make note of that and we'll go back and see if that is available. The COVID section, we don't have as much on COVID this year. We were working in various areas, but there wasn't as much done with COVID this year as it was in the previous year. So there's not necessarily a special section unless it's in the community engagement section, but and Flock and me would know that right offhand. So, yeah. All right. And then if there are any other, like, if you think of questions, like after we get off of this call, please feel free to email us and we will get back to you for certain. Okay, so that is the post board reform, and we're definitely going to be hitting that heavy. So again, we stand strong for the promise of tomorrow. Exactly what does that mean, right? What does that mean? And I'm going to tell you right now what that means. So we are in there. Here's the one thing for sure on COVID, though. Councilmember Crawford. So we did advocate for frontline worker pay, and that's where they providing hero pay, $1,500, and it went to close to 700,000 essential workers, and so that would be healthcare workers. It could be people who drive the vans to the hospitals, and so they had to actually apply for that and state why they were considered essential workers. So that did pass in late April of this year. So we advocated for that, sent bills, letters of support. All right. So there, we also supported an omnibus mental health bill for about $92 million. And unfortunately, like I said, a lot of these things did not pass. They were stonewalled in the legislature. So we are hoping, because we are in a much better position this year where we have support, legislature, the governor, and then also in both the House and the Senate. So the mental health bill, so we're still advocating for that. Let's see. Under economic security, there was a governor's tax bill that we supported, which would have offered child and dependent care credit. There was some jobs and economic development up under that. The governor's tax bill and then the jobs and economic development omnibus was under that. All right. And as I'm looking at that, okay, I'm going to have to take another look at that. But that's economic security. So, and as you look at this, this isn't everything that we supported. These were just some things that we're pulling out. We have a host of bills that we actually supported. But one thing that they said to me this year, they had to cut things because we had done a lot of work. We supported a lot of things, wrote a lot of letters, engaged in many ways out in the community. So they had to cut some things. All right. Okay, so the next area, excuse me, my allergies are cutting up, so work with me, is education equity. So under education equity, a few things that came up. Education finance, there was the education finance and policy omnibus bill. Again, trying to close that opportunity gap, that education gap. We know that our students, we need inclusive learning, rigorous coursework for Black students. We don't always want to be taught at the bottom. We want to make sure that our students have advanced placement classes and that they are able to be educated and challenged at the highest level. We spend a lot of time in that investment in non-exclusionary discipline. We know that for some reason, our students seem to be sent home more often. We're not dealing with the mental health, we're not providing enough social workers, we're not providing enough people in the space to make sure that we're addressing the needs and not just sending our students home. So we're working in that space. And then just like last year, last couple of years, increasing the teachers of color. It's been documented that students learn better from teachers who look like them. And we know that our teachers have a lot to offer, not just our students, but all students. It's an educational learning for everyone. Okay, health, justice, again, another omnibus. And for those of you who are not familiar with the term omnibus, that just means that there's a couple of bills bundled into one bill. And usually that's done after a bunch of bills have gone through. That's usually done kind of at the end. Sorry about that. Okay, so under health, justice, we want to make sure that we're putting money into the spaces where, in health services, where we can have culturally competent people. I mean, we know that there's a problem with Black people going into some of these medical facilities and not getting full information. They're treated poorly. And so there's some bills on the table that address that. And so we supported those bills. We supported child development grant programs, infant and maternal wealth, equitable access to personal care. So those are things. And when I say support, we wrote letters, we had meetings, we met with legislators, and we met with other agencies and other organizations who might be working in these spaces. Okay, so how are we doing on time?
We're good.
Okay, great. So the last piece under this area is the public safety piece. And that, as I mentioned, we spent a lot of time on this. And I would imagine that Flockamy probably will share the Crown Act and even talk a little bit about what's going on with it now. So in this space under judiciary and civil rights, we pushed heavily for three pieces of legislation. One was the Crown Act. Two was non-discrimination in transplants. So apparently, we're not getting the organ transplants like everyone else is. And so we heavily advocated for that. And then the last piece is the pay discrimination, where companies are asking for an applicant's pay history. So if we know that we are in a lot of low-level jobs, then the pay is going to be low. So if companies are asking where you're starting, and then they're using that as a determining factor as to where to start them in their next opportunity, then we're at a loss. We want people to just look at us, look at our skills, look at our talent, and say, hey, this is how much this job is worth. Here's what you're bringing, and boom, as opposed to looking at previous salaries. So that's a big one for this year as well. All right. And then under judiciary public safety, there was another omnibus bill. And under that bill, we want to make sure that we have access to legal aid services. So a low income, disadvantaged, and of course, we're right there. So we advocated for that. We also advocated for investing heavily in community violence prevention. So spending money with groups like 21 Days of Peace and other groups who are working, on the front line, in the trenches, trying to address some of the crime issues. You know, no-knock warrants was another thing that we were working on. And then the missing and murdered women, creating that office, as well as let's look at the expungement of certain offenses. Are there things on the books that we tend to be charged with that are really minor, but because those things stay on the books, we tend to get hit with, oh, well, you can't do this job because you have this on your record. So just looking at all of those kinds of things. And so we spent some time in that space. So that's kind of it for what I was going to talk about. And I think Flockamy will talk a little bit about the community engagement space. But before we do that, there is a couple pages, couple pages kind of at the end that just talks about the budget. You know, our appropriation for 2022 was $544,000. We did not have a rollover last year. For 2023, our appropriation, which for those of you who are new, it's just the money that the government, that the legislature has voted on that will be our budget. So basically every 2 years we have to put together a budget, and then we have to go to the legislature and say, here's what we're thinking we need in order for us to operate. And here's, you know, what we might need extra. Here's, we need extra people or we need whatever, but we have to submit a budget and then they vote yay, nay, and then they decide how much money we get. So for 2023, though, we already were appropriated the $552,000, and then we ended up having that $140 left over from last year from salary savings and us being virtual. But for 2024, and what Chair Hughes was referring to is that now for 2024, we're going to go back to the original appropriated budget of $552. We will not have any rollover funds. Now, it'll be $552 unless the legislature says, hey, for 2025, let's give them an extra amount. So we always go for at least the cost of living increase, which we did, and then see if we can just get some more money. But that is kind of the budget in a nutshell of where we've been and what the progression has been over the last couple of years. So now I'm going to turn it over to Flockamy, who will talk about community engagement and standing strong for the voices that need to be heard.
Thanks, Linda. Are you able to control that, or do you want me to share? Okay.
I will go over.
So real quickly, just to start, we did do a survey, started our survey last year. We're still conducting that. Actually, let me just start with the chronic, because you wanted me to mention that, right, Linda? Because I'll forget if I don't say it. So we did a lot of things last year, and something that was very public facing was the Crown Act. And that is to include hair discrimination in the Department of Human Rights and discrimination policy. This was the second time last year that it passed in the House. It did not get heard in the Senate. However, caveat, it did pass in the House. It passed in the House committee, and then it's up for vote tomorrow at 5:15 on the House floor, and then it's actually going to be heard in the Senate Judiciary and Safety Committee. So tomorrow at 12:30. So if you can be there to support, that's something that's really exciting. And it's a huge movement for us and the folks who have been working on that, just because we haven't seen it go into the Senate. So that I think that's really exciting. Senator Champion is the one who is carrying that bill, but it'll be heard in the committee first. And something else just to mention about that is that was a really great partnership with, like I mentioned, the Department of Human Rights, but also some community partners as well. The Urban League was a huge supporter of that as well, and they brought a lot of their community members out to not only testify but do consistent work with around it, with promoting, but also just exposés and things like that. And we're still in communications with them in terms of what would it look like to expand that moving forward and having discussions around that. And that kind of goes into some of the work that we were doing with not on here, but something that we do consistently is meet with the boards and commissions. And so there's some commissions that are related to cosmetology and, you know, barbers and things like that. And so what does it look like to have partnership with those boards, and what are they trying to change in terms of legislation and things like that? Or, you know, what are the requirements to that, and how can the public be involved in that? So I will just pause on that. That's just a little bit of information about the Crown Act, but I think it does highlight some of the things in terms of, like, my first year here, continuing to build relationships and build and maintain relationships with community partners, but increase our level of interaction with the public as well, from just informing, but to having them be involved in this. So really excited about tomorrow to see where that goes. Back to this, if you can just go back to the first page. I don't know if you're on the first page or the page 7, Linda. So we started off with a survey, like I mentioned, that we had we started with last year, and we did, even though it's still going on, we were able to pull some of the information from that. And so the first page here in community engagement kind of talks about, on the top here, it gives the top 10 highest, these are the top 10 things that folks were concerned about, and that they listed. And this survey, again, is still opened, so we would love to hear from people. I just had a thought, sorry. We still love to hear from people, but you know, this is telling, and hopefully we'll see if some of these, you know, these averages change, but these were the top 10 things here. And focusing on COVID, this year was the first year that we kind of started to gradually go in to the community and outside. The first, I know Linda and Theo started during COVID, or they started and then COVID hit, and then I started in the middle of COVID. So it was kind of a lot of virtual meetings and a lot of virtual events, but this is the first time that we saw some events that were in person. SEMA did a lot of work promoting COVID, promoting vaccines through our bulletins when I came in, but also just supporting community organizations that were having COVID informational sessions and clinics and things like that. We are still and when we go down, you'll see that our first event was in May, and that was something that we, you know, whenever we're doing public events or taking precautions just to make sure that people are safe. Vaccines are things that we still promote, you know, boosters and things like that. We still continue to update folks around COVID, especially around children. I know that that's something that folks are kind of thinking about now, especially with the school year and then COVID and then the flu shot and things like that with winter coming on. So we had our African Heritage Day on the Hill on the 28th. That was a virtual event. That was our second virtual event. And then what that did was we had conversations, we had speeches and opportunities to hear from government officials, including Governor Walz, Lieutenant Governor Flanagan, Attorney General Keith Ellison, and a few other folks. That was a really great event. Different, again, I think people probably were a little bit more used to that just because it was virtual. And it had been a couple of years since people had kind of gotten used to those virtual activities. So that happened in February 28th. Our Get Out the Vote event, like I mentioned, was our first in-person event. And this was in partnership with Fellowship Missionary Baptist Church Senior Ministry. And this was something that we did outside of the campaign season, outside of the voting season or election season, because we really wanted to get ahead of, you know, the noise that people have a lot of times about voting, and really have a conversation of what it means for folks to vote, how their vote is important, and how this is probably the most powerful tool that they have. It was really well received by the community. We also, because the senior ministry was hosting it, we wanted to make sure that we're holding space for all, you know, people from all ages, because we wanted folks to understand like how crucial it was and give examples of, you know, different ways that their votes impact the work that we do. And so that was May 7th. And then, I'm sorry, Linda, I realized that this kind of goes in a weird way. Okay. And then we had our virtual listening session on August 18th. That was really well received. The goal for that was to get information from community members about the 2022 legislative session, what they thought about that, but then also ask them about what they wanted for the next session, what they thought SEMA could provide to them, and just concerns that they have. That was really well received, and we followed up with a lot of the folks that were there as well, just to kind of get them incorporated with the work that we were doing afterwards. Then we had our legislative debrief in September, and that was in person. And that event was it was kind of like a follow-up to all the things that we have done, like, hey, now that the session is over, what are your thoughts? What do you think, what are your thoughts? What do you think could happen in the future? And here are some commentary from folks who have been working on, who have been working to advocate for the things that you have brought to us. And this was a really great opportunity, again, for folks to talk to, like I mentioned before, elected officials. There's really great conversations that came up, especially about, like, how can we make sure that we're disseminating information as much as possible, especially related to, like, there's really great conversations around opioids and things like that. So I thought that it was well received by the community, and there was really great connections made there. One partnership that we had that was kind of for a long span was a mind, body, and soul session hosted by Deputy Commissioner Dr. Stephanie Barrage. She's with the Minnesota Department of Education. They held some listening sessions that were a little bit different, mostly because they were focused on agencies, larger agencies, and then taking that information back. But we were part of that facilitation. We participated in that, and we're also part of facilitating those listening sessions as well. And we heard similar sentiments. One of the things is, access to government, wraparound services, but also holistic approaches to the problems that we're receiving, that we see. Funding was a huge thing, especially for small businesses, and homeowners and renters. That was a really big thing as well. There were some comments again too about, Linda had mentioned the work that we had done previously with the, I was going to say Aaron's second save time, but with the COVID relief for workers, for healthcare workers, that was something that was expressed. People were kind of eager to see some of that, some of those things return, and maybe increase some of the funding for some of those programs. Something else just to mention briefly that's not in here that I think that's really important is that one of the things that I think COVID really showed the rest of the community, the type of support that was given to COVID is something that I think I heard a lot of community members saying that this is something that we would need consistently. Like now I don't want to say people are finally getting it, but it was a time of like, well, what does it look like when we're not in a crisis to provide this type of support and community for each other? Because a lot of times, even without this, we know that a lot of our community members were struggling already. And so a lot of the support sometimes access, again, like I mentioned, businesses, some of our businesses were not able to have access to the COVID relief money. So there's just, what do those gaps look like? And how do we make sure that those things are alleviated? And then again, to, Ms. Secretary Adams Lee's point, yes, it will be in person this February. I just looked at the comments. It will be in person. I didn't want to say that, but since you asked it, it will. So surprise, I'm very excited. I think it will be good, but it will be safe. I think it's a really great opportunity for folks to come together, to network. Kind of going back to that point, like we want to, going back to the point of COVID, making sure that we are keeping really good data and asking about that data and information from other agencies in terms of what they are recording and how they're measuring our work with communities, with our communities. And it's, sometimes it's difficult, right? Because we're like, we can only request so much, but not in kind of like hurry up and wait type of thing. But I think making those asks and making it public that we've done some of that work is one of the most important things. Yes. Should I share the date? Well,
yes, go ahead.
It's February 24th. That's morning, a Friday.
February 24th.
It's February 24th in the morning from 8 to 12. That's the time that we have, but the program will be from 9 to 11. Yes. So we're in the works of planning it right now. It was not.
What is going to be on February 24th?
Oh, that's our day on the hill. So so that's an opportunity for folks to come out, hear from their legislature, and talk to their representatives and learn more about how to get involved so we want to inform them, but I think that there will also be community members who are probably already informed but really want to make this an opportunity to know that they are there. And some people haven't been to the Capitol before. I think we kind of just, at least for me, sometimes I forget, like, that if when you work there, sometimes you forget, like, how to be a tourist in your own city almost. So I think it's a really good opportunity for people to know that this is the People's House. This is where SEMA is located. And just to have that physical understanding of where things are, I think is very powerful. And it also gives onus to representatives also to know when they see our constituency and the things that they're doing and the things that they expect. So, yes.
And one thing about that, too, is that we're doing the Day on the Hill in partnership with ALF and with the Minneapolis-St. Paul Links chapter.
Yes. Yeah. Yep. Thank you for mentioning that, Linda. So they're really good partners. And we've done some work with ALF in the past, too, around policing. I think you mentioned that with Minnesota. I forgot what they're called, the Minnesota Justice Coalition. So I think it'll be a really great partnership again for that. So
are we leading it or?
Yeah,
that's what I'm trying to understand. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it's we're leading it and then they're supporting us.
Yeah. Okay.
Good question.
No, thank you.
Yeah. And so 2022 timeline forecasts. This is the next part here. This is a list of kind of events that we've done with last year. So kind of like a full list of activities. So in January, we had I'm not going to read this whole thing, but January, we had our council meeting. Our annual report was due. Legislative session, day on the hill, spring break. Our council retreat session debrief. And then, so this should say 2023, Linda.
Okay, that's what I was just getting ready to say. Because I'm like, because we're saying forecasting.
Like, what is,
and this is this year.
Yeah. So, so that's kind of like the plan that we have for this year. We're also doing a lot of work. Sorry, Linda, I didn't know if you wanted me to say that part, but I did. So,
this part.
Yeah.
Oh, no, you're fine.
Okay. So this is kind of like a forecast. Again, this is a big overview. It doesn't really include that some of the details that we're doing with our policy and community engagement work. We've kind of already started. Something that wasn't included in here was, you know, we did try to plan for our I totally forgot what it's called. Our policy event. But we pivoted at the last minute with a roundtable, which I think was very successful. And that is, we're still connecting with folks there. The goal for that is to continue that, but really we want to be intentional. Like when I mentioned building relationships with community and what we did in 2022, that, in my opinion, the success of the roundtable is due to the hard work of our team, also those relationships. But then it was one of the biggest takeaways, besides people having a sense of urgency and understanding, like, that we need to connect with, that we need to connect. One of the biggest things that I saw, that was the sense of urgency, but also the understanding that we need to connect and keep in contact with each other as Black individuals. One of the things that I think is that was very powerful, that COVID really helped us do was understand like how to use technology as a tool, especially when we are connecting with people in all parts of Minnesota. That also brings up a different issue of how do we make sure that people have access to that. But I think we know that that is something that we, that it is a necessity in terms of being successful for our communities. So the work for the roundtable, I think, is for me the basis of where I'm starting off right now for the community, for the community engagement, as well as the issue groups. I know we have our Crown Act work tomorrow at 5:15, but I'm going to be hosting some work with I'm going to be doing an informational session with for issue groups and kind of getting that started. And that's more public facing for folks who want to get involved. And then our roundtable is really focused on our stakeholders and folks who also work with community members, but maybe working with, you know, different administrative pieces and things like that. So I will pause there.
So thank you, Flakami, for the community engagement update. And I mean, it's just I am just amazed and thrilled as to how it is progressing. And I hear from my counterparts how they have looked at some of the things that we're doing and said, oh, we need to do that. And so I'm excited about that and just excited about all of the relationships and the inroads that you have been able to make, not just in the African-American groups and population, but also, you know, in the African immigrant and going forward in the Afro-Caribbean and diaspora as well. Yeah. So before we move on too, I just wanted to make sure that we thanked Councilmember Nadi for the workshop, the pivoting workshop session that we did, because he was instrumental in making sure that we had something happening and help moderate that. So thank you for that. Yes. And then also, before we go off of this page, the Governor's 36 MLK Day celebration, we have Councilmember Nadi and then Councilmember Crawford, who are representing us on that. And if you guys want to take a minute, one of you, to just chat about it, what it is, and why we should show up for it, that'd be great. So Councilmember Nadi or Councilmember Crawford?
Councilmember Nadi, I yield to you, my friend.
Thank you. Thank you, ED. And so it's coming up next Monday. It's exciting. We'll be putting things together for the community, and it's in Ordway. I think Linda, you'll be sharing the information. I forwarded you the whole thing so that they get to see what is going on. So the focus of this year is building Black wealth, and actually that's what the governor was, and he's driving. So he made it clear to his department that this year and this administration is going to focus on building Black wealth. Commissioner Steve Grove from DEED, he anchored the council, and he made it very clear. So it's not just within the African Heritage community, but the entire state. So it's an opportunity for us. And we have a lot of entertainment, from the, let me give me a second. So from the keynote speaker who is coming, as well as other dignitaries from the state, the governor himself, some commissioners, some elected leaders as well. There will be drumming, there will be speeches, there is a lot actually that is going to showcase on that day. And you know how best to represent the work of Dr. Luther King Jr. what did for us, than to showing up and bringing family. I think the Ordway has a capacity of over 1,500 people, so all is invited, and the gates will open I think 9:30, and the event will start by 10. So there will be also broadcast on TPT. There will be Facebook. There will be I think also YouTube for those who can't make it. And actually, we want to share it as much as we can. Last year, when COVID was very active, and last 2 years, everything was virtual, and we're able to share it across. So even though there will be in-person meeting in this case, it's also important to have a virtual presence for those who can't make it. And not only in our community, but also statewide, because Dr. Luther King lived for everybody. So his freedom is actually very active in every aspect of life. And it's a treasure for us to be part of the tribute and event.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for sharing that. And I had you talk about it right now just because it's on the calendar. And we will have a table at that event as well. So SEMA will be represented. So, and I just want to also say thank you to everyone who has participated in anything that we've done this past year, whether it's come out to an event, done tabling, come to a dinner, given your thoughts, because feedback is important. And these meetings are important because when we hear thoughts that you guys are, and feedback that you guys are providing, we're going back and we're trying to see how can we incorporate your comments and thoughts. So thank you. I just wanted to say that we appreciate you and look forward to working with you in the upcoming year. So I'm going to stop sharing, I think, here. I think the rest of it, you know, I kind of talked about, or I don't, we're kind of short on time now, so I'm just going to stop sharing. So again, if you have feedback or something that you want us to address, either send us an email, put it in the chat, and we will take a look at it.
So I know the report did go out, so I'm really hoping that people did get a chance to look at it, because we do have to vote on it tonight, because it actually is due Sunday on the 15th. So realistically, Friday. What we've done in the past in these cases is we've actually approved it with the necessary changes that have already been mentioned. When it comes down to the numbers and stuff like that, that's why we try to put the caveat in there, just so that folks know that it's not holistically, you know, what's being captured, but it's what we have gathered from the demographer. Year after year after year, I will say this, and those that have been on the council know this and have looked at the reports over the previous years, that has been an ongoing battle for us to get accurate numbers. So for us to say, well, I'm not going to approve it because it doesn't have, you know, that's something that we're still working with the demographer on. We're not the only organization that I can tell you that still struggles with trying to get accurate numbers. But just know that this is a constant battle, which is why we put the caveat in there so people know that this is not, you know, the all to be all, and it's not all encompassing, if that helps to, you know, kind of add more context to, you know, what we need to approve. I did see that Councilmember Lee had mentioned that she was mentioning, she said, I was mentioning that it's important for us to have data that represents our communities, and we will continue to work with agencies to make sure that that happens. So, because she was asking, I think she had asked something about, and Councilmember Lee, if you could unmute, because I know it was several, there's the chat's been busy tonight. So I was trying to go back up and scroll to the question that you had. So if you can unmute and mention what you had stated, that'd be great.
I was asking, Flockamy was given a lot of information at one time, and so she touched on briefly and said, this is related to what Councilwoman Lee was speaking of, and I missed what the point, the content of what she was relating. What part of her conversation, what part of her update was related to my question that I asked earlier?
Okay, thank you. Any other comments or questions in relation to NECA Creative? Again, did a phenomenal job of the layout. It keeps getting better and better. If we go all the way back to what we used to produce, and then you see what we are producing now, it literally is night and day. And I feel like the context of what's being produced, it really truly is a reflection of what we're trying to do and what we have done. Jude, I see that you unmuted. Go ahead.
Yeah, I want to appreciate the staff for the work they've been doing, especially being shorthanded. I know that at some point Linda was doing the office manager and all of them, and was still able to put all this together. So sometimes, when I reflect on my time in the council, I said, hey, if somebody asks me what have I done and what has the council done since I've been here, I might give it some thought, but just going through this report and all the things I've done in the previous years, we've done a lot, even though it's not something tangible like resources you can see. But when it comes to policy change and legislation, it takes time and it's not that visible, but it's fundamental change. So, and that's how the council is set up to do. So I appreciate the work you guys have done, and actually reflects the council is a lot better than what it used to be. And I'm really proud of you. So thank you, the staff and all the support.
Yeah, absolutely. Hand clap, snaps, all of that. you all have done a phenomenal job. And it's no easy task because of the fact that, you're a small team, a small but mighty team. And I mean, we have a large population. I mean, and we have a lot of, challenges to overcome, barriers that need to be removed. So the fact that we've, been able to do and accomplish what you all have been able to do has been really phenomenal. So yeah, hats off to all of you and everybody else that has been involved. Any other comments, questions, concerns in relation to the 2022 year in review? So I'm going to move on to the next item, which is really to approve the annual report, and keeping in mind that based off of the changes that were recommended so far, so we're approving it with the recommended changes. So if I could have a motion, that would be phenomenal.
Motion to approve with the necessary changes.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Second. Y'all just talking all over me tonight.
Tomorrow, we got you as a second. any further discussion? All in favor, aye.
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 Any opposed? Any abstentions? Awesome. Motion carries. Hats off, team, for that. So Linda, I'm going to turn it back over to you to talk about the excess dollars. What's the plan? Because there were a lot of dollars that we have to expend.
Okay, hold on just a second. So other than what you have seen, there were some things that were mentioned in the notes. So we're still looking at that. And one of those things is the fact that we are looking to see how we can collect more accurate data. If we can hire somebody to do that. Had a couple of little conversations with Dr. Corey, because that's kind of his space. And so, now that Ash is on board, I'll be able to spend more time in that arena. So there are those things. And then also the staff put together a few things that I thought was phenomenal. So one of the things that came up was, do we need to have another strategic plan that discusses the agency's capacity and talks a little bit about speaks to how can we better collaborate with the board? So staff and board collaborations. And then out of that, again, you know, coming up with the project plan, work plan. Equipment upgrade, we have an old projector and display in the office. And although we're working pretty much remotely, you know, we are in the office, you know, once, twice a week, but that we'll be in the office a lot more. And then after COVID kind of lays down for a minute, then we'll be in the office pretty regularly. So we need a new equipment to just make sure that we're operating most efficiently. The artwork in the office is old. So one thought was, do we commission? Then another thought was, let's get artwork that represents all of us so that when people come into the office, they understand who SEMA is and who our constituents are. We need website training. So there's training and things like that that the staff needs. This was on the last thing, but marketing consultant. Maybe we have somebody, hire somebody externally to do social media, virtual and in-person events, or who takes a look at those things and makes recommendations on it. And then maybe we also might hire a contractor to work in that space. There's some technology things that we're looking at. And then some of the money we're looking at, okay, we weren't doing a lot of community engagement events because of COVID. However, we do need to be in the community. And I can tell you it has made an impact. When Justin was here, he had started making some inroads and, you know, people were loving what he was doing. And we picked that up and taken it a step further. And so people are noticing that SEMA is now in the room. And that's through our efforts, but it's also through your efforts as well. Every time you go to an event, and I'm going to call out Councilmember Noddy, because he shows up at everything. I'm always seeing him everywhere. But him, and then I ran into Councilmember Crawford at the governor's event. And so every time you're out there and you're having conversations with people and they say, who are you here representing? And you say, the Council for Minnesotans of African Heritage. Are you familiar with them or familiar with us? And they say no, then that's your opportunity to educate people. And so it, you know, it's just great that we're starting to do that. And so Flockamy is building a community events plan where she is going to be able to get out there more. Again, just some technical things that we want to do. And then professional development, whether that is for staff or for board members. Right now, we only have $5,000 allocated to that, and that's really a drop in the bucket. But if somebody wanted to go to class, take a couple classes, you know, can we afford to do that? And this year, we could. So we'll be looking at that, seeing if there's overtime. One area we're deficient in for sure is that we need to have a photographer do some stock footage. We the pictures that we have are old. NECA was going to be doing some things for the annual report. I'm still waiting to find out what happened with that. I don't know if they were able to get that done, but regardless, we need to start doing that. So we have a lot of things that we're still mulling around. We will make some final decisions on some of those things over the next couple of weeks. One other thing too is we're going to be doing some ads. So ads for Day on the Hill. So some things that we're doing really isn't factored into that the funding yet. So any monies we spend on Day on the Hill, any monies if we decide to do a economic policy summit in June, those are going to cost, that's going to cost money. And so that's not factored into our budget yet. But one of the things that for sure I want to do is support our local media. You know, do we do media buys in the key spaces? Do we start talking about the various issues in those publications? So again, branding for the organization. And then the last piece of it is, so I think that's kind of it for right now, but I will send you something within the next 2 weeks for you to react to. with firm and with dollars to associated to them. So that is a commitment that I am going to make. So that is kind of it.
Any questions for Linda and team?
And please, we love suggestions because these are just thoughts, and some of this still has to be synthesized, but for sure the next couple of weeks I will get back to you with here's the plan and get your thoughts on that.
Go ahead, Jude.
Oh, yeah, thank you for those things. They are fabulous. One thing that is very urgent is the surplus. So that money will be spent in a couple of months to come. And our community, we have some community organizations who know exactly what to do, but we have a lot that need some, you know, hand-holding. I know that Theo was doing a legislative training before, but beyond training, this is actual execution, because when it comes to business, well, if you want to do investment, it might require some money to invest to get more money. So how are we going to support our community organizations who are going for this surplus and also the budget? There is everything requires a kind of investment when it comes to sponsoring a bill, you know, bringing people to support, reaching out, and even all kinds of things. It takes a lot. It's a very lengthy and process, and a lot of for our community members are not well trained to take advantage of that. And some other ethnic groups are pretty good in doing that. And at the end of the day, when that money is gone, it's gone. So if there's a way to invest to really make sure, I was listening to Kemoje 2 days ago, and somebody, I don't even know the guy, but he said, we're tired of crumbs, you know, that they know how to divide our community. They will come to us, they give somebody $250,000, another person will have $1 million here and there. And then the rest of the money will go to other places and not to our community. And the guy said, I'm tired of that, not even $100 million. I'm talking about $2 billion. We need that money to come to our community. So people talk about that, but how do they work? Or how do we support those who really, who be out there to execute and make sure that this is a reality? I think that's a heavy investment, and I think it has to be prioritized because this session is already started.
That I can't really answer, Jude, but if someone came to us and said, you know, we're trying to do this, we would figure out how to partner with them. I know that there are a couple of groups of people who are getting together to try to move bills forward or create bills. And I know last year we actually went to the revisor and served as the lead until this group could get a legislator to actually work with them. I guess I can't answer it until something comes up where there is a funding need, and then we can determine whether or not it fits. I know that before I came on board, there was, and you probably were here, there was that conversation about, okay, we can't give money to groups to just do as grants, so we can't do that. But I think that we would be open to, so for example, we're sponsoring a table, but there might be, you know, maybe the community needs more legislative training. Maybe we have to hire somebody, we hire somebody to do that. Maybe we hire somebody to help the community write bills. So I think that there are ways that we can support those efforts. But I think we just need to have more conversation about what that looks like.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, it's a process driven, and it has, because state is involved, but yeah, so something we need to discuss more to look out opportunity how to get that going.
All right, thanks, Jude. Flockme, I know you were going to say something, but I also saw you were typing stuff in the chat too.
Yeah, I put it in the chat. It was just about translation. That's something that we didn't put on there, Linda, but okay. But Councilmember Crawford asked a question too, but I mentioned, you know, I think it's too late for this publication, but yeah. One of the things that we have been talking about, we've played around with some like one pagers in the past of like, here's some information. Since it's a new session, you know, we typically do our policy agenda items and things like that. So, and then like, I forgot what those things are called, those scan things with your phones, we'll put them in there. So I think if we did that, the QR codes, we could, you know, I could see us doing a one pager in just a couple languages. Then that's like dynamic. Mm-hmm. Well, then that's like consistent, and then we can use that for years to come. So,
yeah. Just a thought. And I just put in the chat that, yes, in terms of what NECA is doing, and right now we are responding to what's in statute that we have to have this done by a certain date. But that's not to say that we can't take a look at it. So in theory, this publication will be done, but in, you know, we could possibly take a look at it. But I think the one pager that we've done in the past might be the best hit for that. But hey, it, you know, I'm all about let's take a look and ask. You know, you don't get what you don't ask for. So Flock and me can probably chat with some, you know, translation people.
It was just a thought when I was actually presenting, mm-hmm. and I wrote it down. But
no, it's a good thought though.
I think the one pager would be good too. Then we can test out to see how much we actually need. And I don't know. I'm just throwing it out there. Right. So
no, right. That makes sense. Wayne and Tawana have their hand up.
Okay.
Hold on. Yeah. Let me see who was first. Tawana, you were first, and then Wayne.
No, I'll use the Tawana. That's okay.
Okay. Thank
you. If your comment is on this, Wayne, you can go. I was going back to the money question, how to use the money question. You can go ahead.
No. It's not about that. But let me just add quickly what I wanted to say. Somewhat about the money, but I think Linda. All the lists you give, awesome. I think it covers a lot. I just want to draw attention to the data gathering, because when I think about data, of course, it's broad. It can be more in terms of who we are, you know, looking at numbers and all of that. But I remember when we had a meeting a while ago, the council, I think we all agree that it will be good for this council to be able to create a sort of repository of organizations and businesses. I would think in terms of gathering those data should be something we can do and put it, you know, that we can, what it does for us, it allows us to be proactive, so we can reach out before any organization come to us for anything, that we can provide that information.
Thank you for mentioning that, because that is on our list about creating the repository, hiring somebody to do that. So we'll have to get together. Wayne, you are officially on the committee.
Okay.
Tawana, you have.
Okay, so I just wanted to go back to, and I know I mentioned this before, maybe a few times before, but now that we have a lot of money right now, and it I'm pretty sure it's probably too short notice to make it happen now. But the idea of us having some type of annual event, annual heritage dinner every year, I know we have Day on the Hill and all of those things, but we don't have anything that brings together, you know, the different organizations that we partner with and the people that we want to bring to the table and build relationships with, something that highlights the work that's happening, you know, in our communities. And so I just wanted to bring that back. Hopefully one year that can happen. I just think that would be such a great opportunity to shed light on some of the amazing work that happens that a lot of people don't know about. And an opportunity to celebrate us outside of Black History Month, you know, and if we can make that an annual thing, you know, that would be even greater. And, you know, I know some other organizations, they get sponsors and they get people to table at these events and all of that. And I don't know exactly or remember exactly how the money side goes, you know, in government, but I just think that that would be, I would personally would love to see something showcased like that for us.
That's a great idea.
Yeah,
and I would love to be on the committee.
I didn't know where I was going with this. Something like that for sure.
The one as the chair of that committee.
Yeah, we would need the council members to really get engaged with that because it is a big undertaking to do some type of dinner like that. And maybe we could tie it in with the Economic Policy Summit or something. I don't know, but
yeah.
But Council Member Mullins, I will be connecting with you, me and Flockamy, regarding that for real. So we could take a look to see if it's feasible for this year. Because if we don't do it this year, next year we probably won't be able to do it unless we get some additional funding from the legislature.
Right.
Sure.
Any other? Oh yeah, Carl. I like that.
Right. We're going to chat with you too, Councilmember Crawford.
I'll check and see
what the ideas coming. Keep it coming.
I'll check and see with the Chamber of Commerce. I haven't heard of anything, but I will.
Yeah, they might have
BIPOC. Something. Oh, just kidding. Okay, BIPOC. Yeah, there's probably one. I'll send it. I think that'll be good to have.
Yeah. And two, and sorry, I apologize for jumping in, but even a Black business directory, we could probably partner with like the Minnesota Black Chamber of Commerce or something. I don't know what they're doing, but that, you know, we could take on a couple partners and maybe see how we can get that done. And that could be in, you know, a part of that whole repository thing that we were talking about. So, okay.
Perfect. So let's move on to, if there's no other questions or comments.
I got a quick question. Is the Martin Luther King breakfast different from what the governor is doing?
Yes.
Yes? Okay. Okay. Are we part of that as well?
No, UNCF usually does the breakfast.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
The MLK breakfast that's at the convention center, UNCF usually hosts that.
Yeah, in partnership with General Mills.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We also have, we are also co-sponsoring an event that evening too. I have to read it out because I forgot what the word is called. But it's around criminal justice report. Yeah, Justin's event. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So just so folks know, I was trying to get the actual thing. It's called Criminal Justice Reform Legislative Preview. It's going to be at Sabatini it starts at 6. So okay. Just so folks know, in case, I know it's going to be a packed day for everyone, but we will be there as well.
Right. And we'll have a table too.
So you're saying that this is going to be at Sabatini on the 16th at 6?
Yep. It will be. Yes. Yep. It will be. Let me see if I can put it in the chat.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it should be a really good event because they're bringing in legislators and it should be nice, a good event.
Cool. So I'm going to move us along because I think we may be able to get done a little before 8. So speakers for 2023. So as you noticed, we did not have a speaker this particular meeting. And part of that was because I knew we needed to have conversation around the annual report and just exactly what we're talking about right now. What can the council do? How do we elevate the work that we're doing? How do we get people involved? And so I just wanted to throw out there thoughts around speaker recommendations for 2023. The executive team will be meeting their normal next month, you know, and so we can have conversation at that time that we can start back up inviting speakers in March. We don't necessarily have to invite somebody in February. One thing that we have done, and we've done this during legislative session, I'm hoping we can do it again, is we have invited the Posse Caucus, so the people of color and indigenous from our legislators to come and present what they are focused in on. And so that's kind of what I was thinking, that for February, that that would be good if we can get a hold of them to see if they're available. I know it's always tough when you're in the middle of session, but that was kind of my thought for February. And then March, we can pick it back up on some recommendations as far as who we would want for speakers. And if there are specific ones that you all have in mind, get that to the SEMA staff, and then the conversation can be elevated when we meet, when the executive council meets prior to the full council meeting. Any questions or comments about that?
Madam Chair, I saw a great story last weekend in the cities about a football coach who's a former police officer. He's the coach of the young man who was shot and killed,
I think a year or two ago. Are you talking about Charlie Adams?
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Oh, yeah.
I think he would be a wonderful speaker to talk about the biggest challenge we have, and that is how we love our own community.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And how we support each other and the work that he's doing with uplifting kids and closing the gap in that community.
Okay. Nope, I'm writing that down. Thank you for that. And like I said, if there's others, please don't hesitate to send a note to Linda or anybody from the SEMA team. And then our last agenda item is, Linda, did you get a chance to go through the calendar to see, are there any dates that we have to move? Because we always go through the full calendar, January through December, to see if there's any council meeting dates that we have to move.
I hate to say that I did not.
Okay, so we'll do that. We'll make sure that we approve that next month. So just make a note that we need to put that on next month's calendar, because we always end up running into whether it's a vote, we have a caucus or something that ends up happening and we end up having to move it, or even a holiday. And we try to be, cognizant of religious holidays that are acknowledged and that we do not meet around that time. Or if there's different things that are happening within the region, then we try not to, meet during that time as well. So we'll bring the full calendar to you all next month to see if there's any meeting dates that we need to change. So with that, any other announcements?
I think Councilmember Crawford had a question. I don't know if we addressed that.
Right. Is that in Duluth?
About the barbecue?
Is that in Duluth?
Okay, we making the trip to Duluth.
Right, road trip. Road
Unless trip. You're going to do it. Come on now. I know there's some people out there that can burn right now.
But we seriously
too cold to barbecue.
What'd you say, Yolanda?
It's too cold to barbecue.
June or July, Yolanda. We're talking about June or July.
Oh, okay. Well, make it plain.
Not right now. Look, Dearman said the same thing. It's too cold. Right. Now, y'all know some people still go out there. Don't try it. It's in not the 30s.
Hey, we handed out toys, 21 Days of Peace, in the middle of December in snow. On the corner of 36 and Lindale. So, 2 hours.
Right. It can be done.
I think Mayor Hollis is still with us. If he can give us some words and maybe the support, he might need from us. It was sworn in yesterday. Some of us were there. So if he's still around.
He's still on.
Okay.
Yeah. Been a little quiet just because it's been kind of hectic the last few years, and so finally recovering. But thank you for that, Jude. So I was sworn in yesterday. We had our first city council meeting, and we were able to cut out before 10, which some people would say really, but given what we've been through as a council, it's It was nice to be able to stop before 10. But I think, and I will follow up with this. I know that many of the items that, you know, the council is addressing, you know, affordable housing, juvenile justice, and, you know, we're kind of on the front lines with those things in Brooklyn Park. And I think we're in a place now where we can start taking the lead on some of that. So I know that, you know, we're working on our legislative agenda right now in Brooklyn Park. And one of the things is, I'm sure many of you have heard about Huntington Place. If you have not, it is a place where, you know, anywhere from 2,500 to 3,000 people live there. And they're dealing, it's basically turning into slums. So I go back to Illinois and some of the projects that I saw growing up, that's where Huntington Place is or headed, right? So we're going to be preparing a package, asking for some dollars to address that from the state legislature. And I know that Minneapolis is dealing with some of the same situations, and it's an issue bigger than telling the owners or the management to come up with the dollars, because in many cases they simply just don't have the dollars. And the infrastructure has been going down here for quite some time. So for me, that's an important item. The other one is juvenile, is dealing with our juveniles. And rather than approaching them from a carceral angle, we'd like to take the lead in addressing from a, you know, more therapeutic angle, coming up with some type of facilities. There's very little accountability when we're talking about some of the issues that youth are dealing with, either from how the state is addressing it or with the youth themselves. So how can we take the lead? Because many of the issues we're seeing in Brooklyn Park with youth are coming because there's just no infrastructure for them there. So, and then the third one is just smart development, right? So and as we talk about that, developing the remaining acreage in Brooklyn Park, how do we make sure our African heritage communities, as well as other communities, but I'm talking to Council of Minnesotans for African Heritage, right? How do we make sure it's equitable and the folks who haven't always had a chance to be developers are sitting at the table helping to make those decisions or helping to develop? And the same thing goes for as we develop, you know, vendors that work with the city or we get dollars to come up with creative programming, how are we making sure that people that haven't been at the table are at the table? And one of the issues I'm seeing with that is we need to provide a lot more back end support. And there are folks who are doing a wonderful job with that in the community, but it needs to be a little bit more of that village approach where one person brings that skill set, someone else brings that other skill set, so that everything is tight when it goes before the city council. And as people go through, you know, as people perform their duties, they're checking all the boxes and doing a great job on the work that they actually want to do. So those are the priorities for us right now. And we're working through the agenda. I didn't want to come here when we haven't fully settled on it, but I think we're moving in that direction. So once we have more of a understanding of that, I'll be in front of you guys. And I think the other thing we can use some help with is, you know, the Brooklyn. So there's Brooklyn Park and there's Brooklyn Center. Between us, there's 145,000 people, huge African heritage populations there. And so how do we leverage that 100,000 plus to address our issues? Because many times people focus on African heritage communities in Minneapolis, St. Paul, and other areas, and the resources don't necessarily reach folks in the Brooklyn's area. So how do we leverage that? And the last thing is, how do we leverage our size to begin to control the agenda in the Northwest suburbs, since we're the biggest player. Brooklyn Park is the biggest player, but combined we're the biggest player. So by far the biggest player. So how do we use that to help create an agenda that works for all communities in those areas, right? And we haven't seen that leadership. So that's what we're looking on. We haven't done a great job with that in the past, so give us some time to kind of figure out the blueprint for that. And as we figure that out, I will be bringing it in front of you, because I expect that you'll be hearing more from the Brooklyns than maybe in the past, especially with April out there as well. So,
Madam Chair, I have a question. I know that there was an incident concerning Brooklyn Center. In a videotape or something or other. I don't have all the details on that, But if you do and you think that this is a place where SEMA needs to be responding, we should know about it.
Yeah, you know, I would, I'm in Brooklyn Park. So I would say I heard about the video, didn't necessarily see the video. I think April, from what I heard from yesterday, she approached it in her way. I think the people who released it got a little ahead of themselves in terms of not checking in with the comms department. So usually they go through the communications department, and the communications department would generally say, no,
right.
This is not what we want. They got a little bit ahead of that. So what I would say is you have a new mayor in office right there. Mm-hmm. See how she handles it. I think she'll handle it the correct way. She may or may not need any nudging, but I generally would say someone new who's stepping into those shoes, who's trying to figure out where her support is and where it isn't, right? She's a little more old hat at this than I am. Give them a chance to see what's figuring out. It does to me show that there's a culture at that police department that needs to be addressed. But I think for now, I would say, let's see how they're going to address it before we begin nudging people and they haven't even had a chance to set in. So.
Yeah, I have,
well said.
I saw the video. It's about a police recruit from the police department, Brooklyn Center Police Department. So, and it was military gear, and there was like, combat ready with all the gears and all the camaraderie. So it was just to the community, to our face, that wasn't anything civil, anything that shows all the effort being put in place, especially after the killing of Dante Wright. All the efforts we are making to create that public safety in the city. So it was so awful, and people were highly, highly irritated, and they took it from different community settings and community groups, and they brought it to the city hall yesterday when we had a council meeting. So yeah, it was all about that. And when there was pressure, they took down the video on the Facebook then. So yeah, well, that was all about.
Yeah, I heard about that. And I guess I wasn't thrilled when I heard about it, because it's our, you know, next door neighbors, right? So we kind of set the tone for each other. But, you know, as watching that kind of the new leadership step into office there, I want to kind of see what they do first. And all politics is local. So I would say, you know, let their leadership, they're going to respond how they respond. Those who live in Brooklyn Center are going to take up the mantle. And then I would say, if support is needed after that, I would look to, you know, outside organizations. But first, I would see how they're going to respond first, because I think she's going to be finding her footing in terms of how she deals with those issues. And she literally just stepped into the stepping into the mayor's seat is a little different than being in the city council seat, because everyone is going to be looking at her saying, you set all of the tone, right? So.
So I'm going to move us from this conversation, because it's getting outside of the realm of SEMA. And so I'm going to go ahead.
Chair, can I actually say something?
Yeah,
I think
go ahead.
Something, with all due respect, I think there's something SEMA can do. I would like to actually state that though I am thrilled that we do have a Black mayor in Brooklyn Park, and we do have a sprinkle of diversity on our council in Brooklyn Center, but I am always of the mindset of not leaving a responsibility of change that needs to happen to elected officials. I believe the NAACP actually sent a letter to the city letting them know that video wasn't okay. I think that's something that SEMA can also follow through with as well, just to kind of say, hey, we've seen this video, and on behalf of the people of the African heritage community, this is not okay. And the new mayor actually responded to the video last night on the record. And she made it clear that no one is going to be fired. There's going to be no accountability, but they're just going to do more training. So the city have responded already. So I think if SEMA could send a communication to the city as well, join your voice with the NAACP and kind of stating that, hey, this has come on our table. We've seen this, and we are in disagreement with this tune that is being set. That will also be helpful.
So without elongating our meeting, we got to understand where SEMA's position is. One. Two, it's a very specific video that's in reference to their recruiting practices. And so when we make statements, and typically it would come from either myself or the executive director, it has to be in alignment with the holistic view, if that makes sense. So like when we responded to George Floyd, when we responded to Dante Wright, when we responded to all these other aspects that happened, that was a larger issue that we were dealing with as African heritage individuals. And I'm happy to have the conversation offline, but understanding where we position it, that's where we get murky, because we have to make sure that the context of how we respond has to be a larger issue around what's going on and not just a targeted issue for one specific area, if that makes sense.
Well, thank you, Chair Hughes. And I brought it up because I just heard about it this morning. And we get questions because we are the council.
Right.
And so I think it's important for us to be knowledgeable and for us to understand the position that we're taking, just in case we get asked.
So. And that's why I said this conversation for me would be an offline conversation. Mm-hmm. Not necessarily a conversation for a council meeting, because now we're getting into when do we respond, how do we respond, and really that to me would be a conversation that the executive council, when we meet, we need to bring this up, because I think Carl even brought up a great point about what's our policy around media responsibility and stuff like that. And so if we don't have that, and making sure that we have the parameters covered, that will absolutely be an agenda item for us for February for the executive council to have that discussion, so that everybody's clear of responses and et cetera. And this is not to negate or take away from, I don't condone. I mean, I do know it because I work in that area. So, but I don't condone that. But I also have to be mindful of at what point, do we respond and to what end? Because this is not going to be, and I hate to say it, and I know this is recorded, and that's fine. but this is not going to be the one and only.
Right.
I mean, that's just reality. And so I think we have to really look at this, from a larger context. So with that, do we have any announcements? I mean, I felt like we know about what's going on for Monday. So everybody should know, what's going on for Monday. Are there any other announcements that need to be made that folks want to share, whether it's an event or any other things that we need to support?
I'll just say briefly, on March 22nd, is the Advocacy for Children's Day at the Capitol Rotunda. I will be emceeing that event. It's an opportunity for parents of early childhood age children to come and talk to their legislatures, but also support many bills that are specifically focused on early childhood. So would love the support of the council during that event. And it's usually around between 9 and 11 a.m.
What, and Dre, can you give me that March? What was it again?
March 22nd.
22nd. Okay, thank you. Any other announcements?
Yeah. So just really quickly, we're actually having a celebration in Brooklyn Park for for, I guess, me winning mayor. So that's going to be, I'm getting used to it. So January 13th, this Friday from 7 to 10 p.m. At the Edenbrook Golf Course in Brooklyn Park. So they got a clubhouse in there. We're going to be having it there. So I don't know, we're expecting a few hundred people, but would love to extend the invitation. There'll be some hors d'oeuvres, and it's going to be a cash bar, though. So in the open bar, but hors d'oeuvres and cash bar. And there'll be probably 5 or 6 performances and acts as well. So from across the African Heritage Diaspora. So.
And is anybody here in housing? Because I think there's a housing rally on Wednesday, like at 1:30 at the Capitol. I don't have all the details on it, but someone told me that there was one.
Alfreda, are you talking about, are you asking when our council meeting is? I just see, you can unmute.
Yeah. Yes, so I am.
So our council meeting is always the second, the second Tuesday of the month.
Okay, just make sure.
And we'll have to look though at the calendar just to make sure it's not a conflict with something else.
Right. That's why I asked.
Yeah. We won't know that until next month. And what we'll try and do is once we look at the calendar, we'll probably try to get it sent out prior to the February meeting, just so that if people need to preempt and pre-plan for something else, then we'll make sure that that's done. All right, with that, if we can have a motion to adjourn. Great meeting, you all.
So moved, Crawford.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second, Dahir.
Second, Lee.
Thank you. So you all have a great evening, great meeting. The meeting is officially adjourned. Take care.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year again.
Take care.